type of the Christian life. And we're going to read the first 11 verses here, chapter 10, 1 Corinthians. Speaks of some of the things that they went through on their journey in the wilderness. And a warning to Christians today, using those Israelites as an example for us to learn from. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. It says, "Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized under Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples, to the intent we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. Neither be ye idolaters, after some of them, as it is written, when people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed of servants. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed of destroyers. And all these things happened to them for our examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the end of the world will come." Stop reading right there. We're going to learn some things here. First of all, the Egyptian bondage was a type of bondage of sin. And they were slaves to Egypt, just as people are today, slaves to sin. We're going to look at the parallel here. Through Moses as a deliverer, he was a type of Christ. And we're going to look at Moses and Christ as a parallel. Moses was a type of Christ. And we can see some of the same things that Christ done that Moses done, or was involved in. Both were preserved in childhood. Pharaoh was killing all the male children back in Exodus chapter 2. Maybe chapter 1 in Matthew. Herod was killing all the children 2 years and under in Matthew chapter 2, verse 13 through 15. So they were both preserved in childhood. Moses was hid from Pharaoh, and Christ was hid from Herod. They both contended with masters of evil. I'm not going to turn to all these scriptures, because we'd be here too long if I did. I have a pretty long list of this. But y'all can study this out for yourself. You don't trust me for what I'm saying here, that it is from God's Word. Anyway, I'll give you the scriptures if you want to write them down and study them for yourself sometime. I'm not going to turn and read all these. It comes to take too long to get through all this. Anyway, both of them contended with the masters of evil. In Exodus chapter 7, verse 10 and 11, Moses and Aaron faced the sorcerers, well, I can't pronounce them, or magicians. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 1, we know Jesus was tempted of the devil. They both fasted 40 days. Moses, when he was on Mount Sinai, when he was God had given the Ten Commandments, in Exodus chapter 34, verse 27 and 28. And Jesus fasted 40 days in the wilderness. Spoken of Matthew chapter 4, verse 2. They both controlled the sea. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 21 and 27. Moses controlled the Red Sea. About the work which God done it, but Moses raised his hand, and God had the sea depart and cross the dry land. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 23 to 26, read where Jesus calmed the sea. They both controlled the sea, both fed the multitude. Exodus chapter 16, verse 15, speaks of the manna that the Israelites were fed. Chapter 14 to Matthew, verse 20 and 21, Jesus fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. They places. Moses, when he come down from Mount Sinai, God had given him a command, the Ten Commandments, Exodus 34:29-35. And Jesus had a radiant face. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 2, where it's recorded as a transfiguration, when he's there. Both endured murmurs, complaints. Mariah, the water was bitter in Exodus chapter 15, verse 23 and 24. The Israelites complained, and Moses in Mark chapter 7, verse 2, the Pharisees were on Jesus for unclean hands and disciples. It just goes on and on. A lot of reading in this, if y'all want to turn and read to those sometime. Both were discredited in the home. Moses was discredited because of his marriage to the Ethiopian woman. And Jesus discredited for unbelief of his brother in his own home, John chapter 7, verse 4 and 5. They both made intercessory prayers. Moses prayed for the sins of the people, Exodus 32:32. And Jesus prayed for the church, John chapter 17, verse 9 through 12. They both established memorials. Exodus chapter 12, verse 14. Moses established Passover as a memorial. In Luke chapter 30:22, verse 19. Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper as a memorial. They both had 70 helpers. Numbers chapter 11, verse 16 and 17. Luke chapter 10, verse 1. Jesus had 70 helpers. Both reappeared after death. Matthew chapter 17, verse 3. Acts chapter 1, verse 3. So Moses was a deliverer of the people from Egypt. Egyptian bondage, Christ has delivered people from their sins. All these things that happened in the Old Testament that we mentioned here was a type of Christ. Anyway, Pharaoh's pursuit of Israel, Exodus chapter 14, verse 8 and 9. This is a type of the evil forces we're pursuing, or evil forces pursuing believers. I'm going to turn back and read the Exodus 14:8. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea and made it dry land. This is a type of hindrance removed. Has everybody been chased by Pharaoh and his army? They come to the Red Sea, they had nowhere to go. They were boxed in the Red Sea. This was a hindrance from their escape, from this bondage. Whenever Moses stretched his hand out over the sea and made it dry land, it was a hindrance removed. Type of hindrance. The believer today can have hindrances or obstacles removed if you let the Lord lead you. Turn to Matthew chapter 21, verse 24. Matthew chapter 21, verse 21. Jesus answered and said to them, verse 20, when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how soon is the fig tree withered away? And Jesus answered and said to them, verily I say unto you, if you have faith and doubt not, you shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree, but also if you shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. All things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. We're not going to be able to ask God to move the mountain out of our way. He's not going to do that. But the mountain here be considered a hindrance. He will remove hindrances. And he put it this way, I guess, well, we need to have enough faith. If we ask God to do that, he would do it. But he's not literally going to move a mountain. But he will remove hindrances if we pray and ask him. All the world allurements that Satan has can be a hindrance to the believer. Unbelief, lack of faith, family ties, you can just go on and on with the list of things that will hinder the believer today. All of these can be removed by the Lord if we will ask and have faith. Y'all got anything you want to add? We'll just speak up. We're not preaching, we're here to bring lessons, so if you have anything you want to add or say, whatever, speak up. Anyway, the pillar of cloud and fire, next to chapter 14, verse 19 and 20, is a type of divine presence with the believers. God was with his Israelites in this cloud. It was protecting them, keeping them from Pharaoh. Turn to Exodus 14, 19 and 20, we'll read that. Exodus 14, 19, 20. Said, and the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them, and the pillar of the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel, and it was a cloud and darkness to them, but it gave light by night to these, so that the one came not near the other all night. So this cloud was a type of divine presence. The Israelites, divine presence is assured to the smallest assembly of believers. It's like tonight, you know, we're only just a few. God's here with us. He promises in Matthew chapter 18, verse 20, so where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of. So God's presence is with the believer. Divine presence of God be a comfort to believers in trials of this life. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, God promises to be near or never leave the believer or forsake him. So God is with his people. Presence is always with his people. Let's turn back to Exodus chapter 15. I'll read this in verses 1 through 19 of Exodus 15, which is titled the Song of Spiritual Victory. It says the Song of Moses. And we as believers today can sing songs and praise the Lord as Moses did for spiritual victories. Chapter 15, verse 1, Exodus. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song to the Lord. Spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed towards me. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength, Saul. He has become my salvation. He is my God. I will prepare him a habitation. My father's God, I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his host have he cast into the sea. His total captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depth has covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. The right hand of the Lord has become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, hath dashed in pieces the enemy. In the greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sendest forth thy wrath, which consumed them as stubble. And with the blast of thy nostrils, the water were gathered together. The floods stood upright as a heap. And the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied. I will draw my sword, and my hands shall destroy them. I did blow with the wind, the sea covered them, the sank as lead in the mighty water. Who is like to thee, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious and holiness, fearful and praises, doing wonder? Thou stretch out thy right hand, the earth swallowed them. Thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people for salvation. Thou hast guided them in thy strength to thy holy habitation. The people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold on the inhabitants of Palestine. If then in thy duty shall be amazed. The mighty men of Moab trembling shall take hold upon them. All the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away. Fear and dread shall fall upon them by the greatness of thine arm. They shall be as still as a stone. Thy people pass over, Lord, shall the people pass over which thou hast purchased. Thou shalt bring them in, plant them in the mountain of thine inheritance, in the place, O Lord, which thou hast made for thee to dwell in. In the sanctuary, O Lord, which thy hands have established, the Lord shall reign forever and ever. For the heart of Pharaoh went in with his chariots, with his horsemen, into the sea, and the Lord brought again the water of the sea upon them. But the children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. Song of Moses for their their spiritual victory. Again, we can sing a song for, as Moses did, you know, for spiritual victories. We can have victory over sin as Moses had victory over Pharaoh. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 teaches us to show faith. Show forth the promise of him who has called us out of darkness. Spiritual victory. Show faith, or show forth the praise of him who has called us out of darkness into to light. A Christian should delight in singing God's praises. I notice a lot of times in our Psalm 30, everybody not singing. That's fine, you know, people can't sing or don't feel like singing, got a sore throat or something. That's fine, but if a person is able to sing, I think they ought to participate in song service and sing praises to God. We got a lot to be happy about, to sing about. We're heirs of God, joint heirs of Jesus Christ. We do have a spiritual victory over sin. And we talked about the bitter water, a type of bitter and sweet experience of the Christian life. Christian life, it can be much more enjoyable by being obedient to the Lord. If one is not obedient to the Lord, then his life can be miserable. It can be under the testing hand of the Lord and be very bitter if he's not in God's will. James chapter 1, verse 25, I'm going to read here, we're blessed or promised for obedience. God's going to bless the obedient child. It's just like a parent that has an unruly child. They're not going to be in the parent's favor if they're not doing what the parent wants them to do. The same way with God. If his children are not doing what he wants, doing his will, then they're not going to be in his favor. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 6, God's wrath is promised to the children of disobedience. All these things that we read about there in 1 Corinthians were for our example. These things that happen, he deserves a life. The man that they had eaten is a type of Christ, which is the bread of life. And you speak about the man in Exodus chapter 16, verse 4. James chapter 6, verse 32 to 35, speaks of Christ as the bread of life. The Israelites had to have food. God sent manna down from the east to sustain them. And for us to have life everlasting, we must have the bread of life. We must know Christ as Savior. The water from the rock, Exodus chapter 17, verse 6, is a type of Christ, the living water. We read there in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, long ago. John chapter 4, verse 10, says Christ is the living water. The upholding of Moses' hand when there were a war against Amalek. Exodus chapter 17, verse 11 and 12. Says here, it came to pass when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed in his war. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hand was very heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hand, the one on one side, and the other on the other side, and his hand was stone until he was going down the sun. So when Moses' hand were held up, they prevailed against Amalek. When he dropped, they were losing the battle. And we can that was a type of need of cooperation with leaders. Whenever Moses' hand dropped, he needs help. He couldn't hold his hands up, they were tired. His arms were heavy. So he needed the cooperation of the people to help him hold up his hands, but they were winning the battle as long as he was holding up his hands. Anyway, we as a church need to do the same for our pastor and our church. We need to have monetary support for the church. We're talking in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. And prayer is sought in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17 and 18. So we need to pray for our church and pray for our pastor, our leader. He needs the support of the church. We have to have the support, monetary support, to take care of the business. We need to support our pastor with our prayer. God, we bless him. He can do his work. There in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6 through 11, says these things were written for our example. Verse 6, now these things were our example to the 10 which did not lust after evil things, as they also must. And to be the idolaters, that were some of them as written. People sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to play. That sounds like the world today, don't it? All people want to do is party, play, party, play. There's other things in life besides partying and playing. It says, neither let us commit fornication, some of them committed and fell one day. 320,000. That's a lot of people dying one day. I was reading this under the morning report, in the world that they bury all those people out there in the rocks. Man. Verse 9 says, they let us tempt Christ, the Son of all sin, also tempted and were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye, some of them also murmured and were destroyed of and destroyed. All these things again happen to them for examples that are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world will come. So this was written that we might learn, be instructed of what happens whenever you sin against God. Life in the wilderness for these Israelites was typical of the Christian life. It was hard at times. God disciplined, and because of disobedience, of the word, for us to grow in knowledge and learn on how we should obey God, follow his commands, and if not, we're going to be chastened. We can learn from these things and be obedient to the Lord's command. We can be defeated by living carnal lives. Satan can defeat us as a Christian if we live a carnal life. But if we live an abundant, victorious life, we have to live spiritually. To have a spiritual life before we're going to have an abundant, victorious life. And this again, God doesn't make us do anything. He commands us to do something and asks us to do it, but he don't make us do anything. So it's our choice. We can live for God or live for Satan. But if we live for Satan, we're going to be chastised. We can have an abundant life or a victorious life by living spiritually. Yep, I'm going to end that right there. And I thank y'all for coming. And nothing we're going to learn here is something to remind us of y'all. Israelites were an example, because we need to live for God. Some of the things that happened to them. Appreciate y'all coming.